Okay, everybody, welcome back to the shop. It's only a few days later. Maybe it's a week, maybe it's not quite a week. Anyway, another very interesting question that requires a long-winded answer, which some of you will not enjoy. A lot of you hopefully will. Okay, so first of all, the Orenda 14, we have one fuel pump done. The other one is being assembled and they're both gonna be tested as soon as that happens. Hopefully within the next week. Takes a long time because there's other things going on and it's a bit of a big deal to set up the equipment to test the fuel pumps. But then the next thing we're gonna do is the fuel control. The fuel control goes right here. Those are the two mounting doohickeys. And at that point, it's gonna be just about ready. So what I can do now, because I've finished the bottom stuff, the stuff that you would have to work on laying upside down with the engine in the stands. That's all finished. And upcoming in the week, we're going to be turning it horizontal. You can follow all of the procedures and all of the steps right from the very beginning when it rolled in the door over two years ago, September 2021, this thing, the complete rebuilding and restoring of it on the Patreon channel. So anyway, that's what's coming up. The test is gonna be probably a couple of months away, but we're getting there. It's gonna be a brand new Orenda 14. It's gonna be awesome. So those of you watching on Patreon, thank you very much. You're helping keep things going. And if you like videos in the shop of working on the engine more than me yakking to the camera, you're gonna like it. And it's one of the best deals going. Anyway. Our excellent question, it's a two-parter, and at the end of the question, he's talking about mentioning something about this. But this is just a good old reliable, what's the insider term for it? It's a K25. It's a 2007 BMW R1200 GS. They call it a K25. I like K25 better. But anyway, black and silver. I didn't mean for it to match, it just does. So. Let's get down to the question while keeping my face well out of close-up range for wrinkles and pockmarks, eh? I knew you'd appreciate that. I'm always thinking, not about productive things, but always. Okay, so this is from Fast Midis. Anyway, his profile picture, it looks like, I can't tell if it's a race bike or not. I think it's a race bike. I can't tell if that's a number sticker or a headlight. Anyway, he's got a motorcycle as his avatar, so respect for the brethren. Okay, he says, greetings from Greece. My question is, when, why, and under which circumstances will these engines from the 40s, 50s, and similar age stop to be efficient, effective, productive, economically viable, or even unserviceable due to lack of parts? When a turbojet engine stops to breathe hot gas for ground use, when one of these engines stops to breathe hot gas for ground use, so I guess that means it's scrapped. What is the next choice for industry and other grounded use? Thanks a lot for your effort and educate us. Be well. A few comments on the BMW from the aspect of mechanical build quality, performance, function. Sure, I'll give you one comment on this. You know how an engine, when the valves that, you know, mechanically adjusted valves, they need to be adjusted every once in a while. Not so much in American production V8s and cars, not so much in Harleys, but a lot of bikes have mechanically adjusted valves. So you got the shim type, which basically never need adjustment, and the screw and lock nut rocker arm kind. That's what this has. So after a 9,000 kilometer ride, and believe me, on the first day, like an hour after I left on this 3 week long adventure, I could hear some tickety, 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 tick, 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 tick. Now I know that that's my mind grasping onto the tiniest detail and magnifying it into a nightmare. So I just told myself, ignore it. It was good yesterday, it's good today. So I did that all the way through the trip and it got louder and louder and it changes depending on the mood of the engine, what mood it's in, what emotions it's feeling, because sometimes it's fine. Other times it's like, I don't know, hitting a bottle with a hammer. It's a very loud whackety whack 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 whack. And I heard that. I was in between Montana and Washington is a section of Idaho that's a mountain pass, and it's awesome. I was there. I'm hearing this rat-a-tat-tat-tat-tat-tat-tat. I'm in the middle of a long ways from any towns. So I was really worried, and it just was so loud. I thought, I'm destroying this engine. And I said, I'll fix it when I get home. So after a bunch of stuff happens, and it comes and goes over the next 4 or 5 days, I get home. I pull off the valve covers, and I go to adjust the valves. And they are, about 1/1000th of an inch too loose. Which is strange, because as valves wear, don't they tighten up? Anyway, I thought I was going to find dents and pock marks and just, you know, shiny, rattly, damagey, metally stuff, you know? But no. It's the, on a Honda, you got the cam pushes on a rocker, this little part pushes on the valve. It's a bare pad of steel pushing on a bare pad of steel. It's okay. It doesn't ever get marked up. It works. And I thought, if that's the same thing, something's going to be dented, because man, it was loud. This thing doesn't have the end of the push rod, not end of the valve stem. Yeah. It has a little foot. It looks like a horse's foot. A nice flat surface that sticks against the follower, and a little joint to the end of the valve stem, like a little horse's foot. It looks like a horse's foot. And showed no signs of, not even any shininess, nothing. Beautiful. Anyway, that's my comment on mechanical build quality and reliability. I don't know if that's good or bad. It felt good to me. You can decide. I'm sure I'll hear tons of comments about how crappy it is compared to shim under bucket, whatever. Okay, for your enjoyment. So, his question is actually many questions. It says, when, why, and under which circumstances will these engines from the 40s, 50s, 60s, and similar age stop to be efficient? Okay, well, they weren't efficient when they were new. They're not efficient now. But at the time, they were the only way. They were the cutting edge of engineering, performance, and speed. 650 miles an hour. 650 miles an hour. And it burns about 1 pound of fuel per pound of thrust per hour. That's the specific fuel consumption. Pounds of fuel used per pound of thrust per hour. So that's running wide open, 100% for 1 hour. How much fuel would it use per pound of thrust? So this is about one. So quite inefficient. A modern airliner is about 0.3. Maybe a modern turboprop can get into the just under 0.3. And piston engines are, well, if you run them at full power, I don't know. I don't know what piston engines SFC is. But a lot more than one, let me tell you. In the afterburner, the J79 uses 2.97. So 2.97 pounds of fuel per pound of thrust per hour. That's a lot. That's way more than the plane can carry. And you can't refuel in afterburner, so I don't think anybody's ever done that in a Phantom. 1 hour at maximum burner, you don't have that much fuel. So anyway, they never were efficient, but I'll intercede right here to say that I don't really work in what you might call general aviation. I don't even work in military aviation. I work in a very strange little, quirky little niche that makes this engine valuable. Because it's a single seat fighter jet from the 50s that happens to be a very attractive plane. I will put links in the description to people's aircrafts that I have worked on the engines flying in air shows. And it's a beautiful aircraft. So people who can afford it, and they want a jet fighter, they want a cool looking plane, they get the Sabre. There are others, but the Sabre is darn cool. It also happens to be, according to Steve Hinton and a few other semi-famous jet pilots, it's the It's the pilot's airplane. Among the aircraft that people like to fly the most, pilots like to fly the most, are the Spitfire, the Mustang, the F-86. Those are probably near the top. There's others. They're all great, but for handling-wise, those three are very near the top. Okay, hang on. Got my Warbird shirt on. All right, so the people that fly the Sabre that uses this engine, they're also history buffs, history fans, history enthusiasts. They want the plane to be the plane. If you had a, let's see, for car guys, if you have a 68 Charger, yeah, do you want to have an LS engine in it? You could do that. You could do it. It'd be more reliable, even make more power. But no, you don't want that. You want a, do you want a 440, like Roadkill? Or do you want a 426 with a six-pack? I mean, you can put anything in there, but you want it to be the real thing. So the real thing is a Sabre Jet with one of these, or a J47. You could certainly increase the efficiency by putting a, I think it's a Garrett TFE 731. Is that big enough? I'm not sure if that's big enough. You could put that in, you could probably even fit a J57 in there. And then you'd have a super hot rod Sabre. That's the engine that came in the F100 Super Sabre. But it's like, well, how much do you want to chop up your original collector's aircraft, your historically significant original aircraft? How much do you want to hack it up so you can fly it and go fast? Because you can spend a lot less money and get an aerobatic aircraft that'll go as fast and be more maneuverable and do more crazy things and probably be more reliable if all you want is performance. So my little niche is supplying the period correct, the actual numbers matching engine to the airframe so you can have a real Sabre Jet. So I imagine there are people out there, I can't understand them, but I imagine there's people out there that would say, yeah, so what? Put a this in it, put a that in it, put a J79 in it, what the hell? Just make it go, put a rocket engine in it. Well, the engine's only one part of the aircraft, and the aircraft is literally a, is it a collector's item? It's more than that. It's a piece of national history for the US and Canada and a lot of other places. It's beautiful. When a little kid thinks of a jet fighter, he might think of the F-22, he might think of the F-15, he might think of a Phantom, he might think of an F-35, but he probably sure thinks of an F-86. It just looks right. It's too bad these planes aren't current anymore because they look awesome. And so that's why these engines, they're my business. I lost my message again. Economically viable. Well, nothing's economically viable. Although we had a Sabre Jet. Here's some numbers for you. We had a Sabre Jet that was worth $100,000 US. Why? Because it was in a million pieces. It was completely disassembled, like a giant Airfix kit. It took up half an acre on the floor. And it was all there, just had to be put together. And when you want to put together an airplane to fly it, everything's got to be, if not new, in new condition, just like this engine. So all the rusty hinges and all the crusty bolts and all the dirty things and the dented lines and the frayed cables and all that stuff had to be fixed, made brand new, and put together. Well, somebody bought that, and they run a business that does that. They restore old aircraft. So they said, all the pieces show great potential. They need a lot of work. We're going to put it together. That was a couple years ago, so it's going to be flying soon. That's going to be a newly restored F-86 Sabre, which is really something, because I think there's only a dozen of them in the world. So that thing is an economically viable project for somebody who's used to doing that work. What's it going to sell for? Millions. But it's going to be worth it for somebody that wants one. So if you found a smashed up, not a smashed up, a disassembled and corroded, even a 737 in a field, all the parts are there. They're just all covered in mud and they're rusty and it just needs to be put together. Nobody's going to want to do that because it'll cost more to do that than it will be to go buy a new one from Boeing. Well, you can't buy a new Sabre. So So that's why this is economically viable, I suppose. Not in the normal sense of the word. My accountants think that I'm trading on thin air. I guess I am. And a lot of people think, well, what's the point? It's just a plane. Okay. But these particular engines, they're going to be immortal. If anything ever wears out on this engine, it'll be replaced with something else. And in the future, people will be 3D printing all the parts for this. So this will last forever. Okay, so unserviceable due to lack of parts. Well, that's the same thing's happening. This engine here contains the last set that I have, that I had in my inventory, of new main bearings. So what happens in 20 years when it needs new ones? Somebody will have to find some, a bearing manufacturer will have to make some, or somebody will have to somehow make the bearings. The problem with getting a bearing manufacturer to make them is they'll say, yes, how many thousands do you want? Oh, we want one. Even if you said, we want 10, they say, you got to be kidding me. It's $1 million setup, and then it's only $10,000 a set. So the first one costs $1,010,000. If you make two, they cost $510,000, and so on until you get the economies of scale. So that's why you don't go to any of the big bearing manufacturers and say, yeah, I want one of these. They really use two in the engine, but, you know, whatever. So that's a difficulty. Okay, and then he goes, when a turbojet engine stops to breathe hot gases for ground use. So not this particular engine, but the Orenda 14 is the basis for another engine called the OTF 390. And it is the same thing. It looks just like this because it's got no accessories on the outside. It burns natural gas, usually, and it's an industrial engine. This engine has about, I think it's got about 1,000 hours of use on it. An industrial engine will get hundreds of thousands of hours before it's finally scrapped. And it's usually scrapped. It would be scrapped when the entire power plant or installation is decided to be decommissioned for whatever reason. There's all kinds of reasons. But the engine will be kept going forever, because even if it costs $1 million to restore an engine, that's way cheaper than throwing away the entire installation, like the building, the generator, the electrical equipment, if it's making electricity, the fuel system, the control room, everything. Because if you put a different engine in there, they're all different shapes and sizes and capacities. This is a second seven megawatt electrical generators are hooked up to this. So there's my video called Megawatts. This is one of these, makes 7 megawatts of power. So modern engines might be, they are more efficient. They might be lighter. They'll be bigger. Might make 15 megawatts, might make 40 megawatts. So the electrical utility or whoever wants that power gets to decide, but is there a 7? No, there's not a 7. You can use an 8 and turn it down. That's less efficient. You can use 2 3500s, or what do you want to do? You can make 10 megawatts of power and sell 3 of it to the grid. Whatever you want, but that means you have to completely design and install a totally new stand, fuel system, electrical generator, inlet, exhaust, building, the whole thing. It's millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars to change from what you're using. So that's another reason why they stay in use for so long. Productive. Well, they're always productive. No matter how inefficient your jet engine is, it's going to make power. Yeah, and when it stops making power, you send it to somebody like me and we make it make power again. So a very interesting question. My case is not typical because of the historical value of these things. If a company, well, it's hard to compare to the car world, but let's say that a company was restoring taxi cabs. the Chevy Caprice or even the Checker. I don't think they use those anymore. But if they were restoring taxi cabs for a big company and trying to sell them in big cities all across the US, they would do okay. But it wouldn't be the same if there was a company that was restoring Porsche 917s. Because no matter how much that thing costs, it's gonna sell. No matter how much a Porsche 917 with factory parts and factory specs and factory performance, the real thing, it's gonna sell. Even if you can't drive it on the road, it's gonna sell. So, and there's many, 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 many cars like that. This is one of those cases. This is the correct engine for an F86F Sabre Jet. And the people that want those, they don't want another engine in there. They want the real thing. And they want it to be safe, and they want it to be reliable. Okay, so for me, these engines will remain productive, economically viable, and efficient as long as I can put them together. And this might be the last one I build. It's not building it from scratch, but it's creating a new serviceable Sabre Jet engine out of a vast field of surplus parts. So this has got parts from about 6 different engines in it. That's different than taking a complete engine in the shop and refurbishing it by using a few new parts. That's a lot easier job. But that kind of work on these engines will be around as long as the Sabre Jet exists, because the people that fly them, they don't want to, I don't know, I guess they'd fly them no matter what's in there, but they would prefer to have the actual proper engine in it, you know? But if it was an industrial engine, it'll last as long as parts exist, and the similar thing is going to be happening with the bearings for industrial aircraft. They use the same parts inside, that there is no manufacturer. We saw in my last video, you saw the world, not all of it, but a large proportion of the world's inventory of Orenda parts in those rusty cans. So there's a few people out there, we're trying to find them, that have listed new, brand new factory sealed bearings for these engines. If you're one of those guys, contact me, I want to buy them from you, I'll give you lots of money for them, because they're just not available anymore. And what's going to happen in the next cycle, probably after I retire, somebody is going to have to get a bearing manufacturer to crank out 100 or so sets of those things, spend a great deal of money, but then they're all worth whatever, $20,000 a set. So you make your money back, but you got to put a lot of money up front. An industrial engine doesn't typically get retired. It only gets retired when the whole installation gets changed over to something else. We had 3 LM1500s, which are natural gas burning versions of the J79, of those engines down in an American state pumping natural gas, and that state has banned, I don't know what they've done exactly, but they've forced the owner of those engines to shut them down and go to electric motors. So that's how those engines got retired. And they will undoubtedly come back to us. One of them is we own it. It's a rental, power by the hour. I call it the rent-a-jet. What do they call it? I forget what they call it. It's like a reserve. It's the lease engine. That's what it is. They call it the lease engine. I call it the rent-a-jet. Anyway, there's that one and two engines that they owned. Well, they're still good. We'll take them back, refurbish them, and some other operator in another country or another area where there's less, I guess, regulations against burning of fossil fuels, they'll use them, because it's 12,500 horsepower in a nice convenient package, and it does work. So when does it get retired? That's a good example of the facility deciding to shut down the operation. The engine's still good, so the whole thing gets shut down. Like with anything, but especially with turbine engines, if you are willing to keep up the maintenance, it will last forever. So on this beautiful smoky Sunday, Monday, it's Thanksgiving. The forest fires around our town have sparked back up, so it smells like a beach fire out there. I went out to my truck this morning in my driveway, and there was ashes. Little tiny bits of ashes. Looked like snow, but it wasn't. Wood ash all over the windshield. On that note, thanks for watching, and check back later.